Hello, welcome to Italics, the Italian-American magazine. I'm your host, Lucia Grillo. Dean Anthony Tamburi is on assignment in Perugia, Italy. He will return next month. On Sunday, May 20th, an earthquake measuring 6.0 on the Richter scale occurred near the region of Bologna, Italy. The earthquake resulted in the deaths of at least 5 people and the damage of much historical architecture. Our thoughts go out to all affected by this devastation. We will report more on this story next month. First, we'll go to the Calandra Institute for our annual conference, whose theme this year was Reimagining White Ethnicity, Expressivity, Identity, Race. The conference, held at the Institute from April 26th through April 28th, was co-sponsored by the Center for Byzantine and Modern Greek Studies at Queen's College, CUNY. Next, we'll take you to a lecture on the book Celluloid Activist, The Life and Times of Vito Russo, written by Professor Michael Schiavi. Celluloid Activist explores the gay Italian-American hero and iconoclast. Vito Russo's book, The Celluloid Closet, Homosexuality in the Movies, is universally considered a foundational work in gay and lesbian film studies. Now let's go to the Calandra Institute in Midtown Manhattan for the conference Reimagining White Ethnicity, Expressivity, Identity, Race.
A couple of years ago, I was invited to Ohio State University to talk about contemporary Italian-American identity. And I was told that Yirgos Anagonostou would be being the discussant for my paper, and he had a new book. And I picked up Contours of White Ethnicity and was pleasantly surprised by this new publication, because it brilliantly addresses a number of issues that those of us who deal with Italian Americans are also dealing with, in particular, but not limited to race, expressive culture, hybridic identities, and the reinterpretation of the historical past. And there was enough difference and similarities going on between Italian Americans and Greek Americans, and that there was clearly a rich exchange of ideas. And in consultation with Yirgos, with Anthony Tamburi, with Fred Gardefray, and many other colleagues that are friends and friends of the Calandra Institute, we developed this year's theme, Reimagining White Ethnicity.
Let me say how pleased and really we're proud that we are co-sponsoring this very important conference.
The invitation to reimagine ethnicity reveals discomfort about the ways in which we imagine white ethnicity in the nation. The topi of this national imagination are deeply entrenched. The white ethnic as an exemplar of national openness, progress, and equal opportunity. As a self-sufficient figure who, through toil and determination, overcame discrimination to realize the American dream. Thus, when this conference makes white ethnicity its central inquiry, it historicizes ethnicity, connecting it with power relations. It probes researchers to ask questions. It proposes to examine cultural expressivity in relation to political economy. It makes it difficult to discuss heritage and identity as aesthetic phenomena independent from racial hierarchies. But white ethnicity is fundamentally a problematic category. This is because it tends to cluster collectives with distinct histories and cultures under a single rubric. It homogenizes diversity, risking essentialization. Not all white ethnics, in quotation marks now, fit into the dominant classification of whiteness, neither do all white ethnics consent to the ideology of whiteness. The category tends then, in other words, to objectify populations which are ideologically diverse and may be assigned into different ethno-racial categories. And it is this logic that drives many scholars to seek to go beyond white ethnicity. Here then is the primary framework for us as scholars and activists to contribute to a more just society.
In attempts to bring New York into focus after the tragedy of September 11, 2001, what becomes reinscribed even when, as in Let the Great World Spin, the narrative is populated with ethnically and racially diverse characters is a national narrative of dominant white privilege that denies and mitigates New York's impact as a global and cosmopolitan city. Now, while this narrative privileges a certain kind of white ethnicity, this palimpsest lumps white ethnic immigrants into one group. The women all seem to be of Italian, Irish, or Polish white ethnic makeup, but their presences are only marked by first names and simplistic descriptions. We never find out anything of substance about these women. If this trio of women is meant to represent the idea of white ethnicity, Italian-American males are singled out as overtly aggressive and violent oppressors. There was a pizza place on Lexington. The guys were fat and hairy and always making jokes about pepperonis. The syndicates used to come around too. You didn't want to mess with the syndicates. They had a crease in the trousers of their suits and they smelled of brilliantine. They might bring you for a nice guinea meal and then you end up taking a dirt nap. Tilly's description of these men expands on a superficial level the racial and ethnic connections within the city, but it is telling that white authority does not confront these men. The least powerful person and a stereotype in her own right in the narrative is the one who does.
Solvang in Southern California was founded by Danish immigrants coming from, not straight from Denmark, but from different places in the US. In 1947, some journalist from the Saturday Evening Post came to Solvang and he wrote a very nice piece. So from then on, tourists will keep coming. So they had to invent Danish Days, which is the annual celebration of their Danishness and the Danish Days mate. When I interviewed around and inquired about the rules and who had been and who had not been, the name of one particular girl came up again and again. And she was the daughter of Lisa and Bent, both straight from Denmark. They have one daughter, Christina, who speaks Danish, who has been to Denmark many, many times. She has also been somewhat part of the community. Everybody knows her. And here's Christine. So what she was saying was the Danish Days mate doesn't necessarily get to talk to everyone and see her and talk about her heritage. So it would make sense to make sure that she looks Danish. Looking Danish, to clarify, is, you know, Caucasianish, she says.
It seems that the most widely referenced quotation in academic criticism by Republican and former superintendent of the Arizona School District, Tom Horn, is his own referencing of a speech by Martin Luther King, Jr., embedded in Horn's opinion that ethnic studies courses for high school students build a dangerous type of solidarity. Specifically, in his 2007 open letter to people of Tucson, Horn attests, in the summer of 1963, having recently graduated from high school, I participated in the Civil Rights March on Washington, in which Martin Luther King stated that he wanted his children to be judged by the content of their character rather than the color of their skin. That has been a fundamental principle for me my entire life, and ethnic studies teaches the opposite. What this sorely mistaken conceptualization of ethnic studies implies is that Horn wants racism to go away, and part of what he sees as racism is the pedagogical initiative on behalf of certain cultural programs that teach the utility of building counter-narratives against majoritarian versions of American history. According to the creator of the Mexican-American Studies program, Augustine Romero, the primary focus is to help students develop their critical consciousness, and through this process, we would attempt to help the students develop a strong sense of organic intellectualism. In short, the program had to perform the dual roles of extracurricular mentorship and the teaching of fundamental critical thinking skills. Moreover, the preparedness of participating students in the program more than rivals the preparedness of a typical student in the Arizona school district who is not offered a similar subset of critical consciousness skills. Many colleges have identified in the incoming undergraduate a fundamental and basic unpreparedness to question notions that are posited as facts within American narratives of progress, citing high school textbooks and mainstay courses as the culprits. High school books simply did not address the conflicts and inconsistencies raised by the existence of slavery in the founding of the United States from 1776 to 1800. The texts failed to deal with African American enslavement in any meaningful manner. whereas college textbooks did not pull any academic punches in their treatment of slavery and the founding of the nation. While it is important to incorporate whiteness studies into critical pedagogy in an effort to get unaware and apathetic white students invested in anti-racism, a general enough category that all students share would position them at the center of what they perceive to be their universe, but not small enough that fragmentation on the basis of contrasting racial and cultural distinctions will occur.
Obviously, when the Italian-American community was defending Pietro Balbo, they were not supporting someone who had stabbed his wife. But more than anything, what they were doing was to fight against a judiciary system which they felt did not keep its promise to guarantee equal treatment to all convicts, regardless of race or ethnicity. The fact that justice was not colorblind had become so obvious in the late 19th century that the New York Times itself proposed in a very cynical article to, I quote, amend criminal statutes and rid them of the false pretense that all criminals are born free and equal and are entitled to equal justice before the law, unquote. Now, the Daily suggested that there should be, I quote, a formal recognition of the fact that all Negroes accused of crime are to be regarded as guilty unless they can prove they are innocent, unquote. Thus, the New York Times concluded with sarcasm that the only way to avoid that criminals be accused of partiality when dispensing justice was to include formally those discriminations in the statute book.
The emergence of ethnic consciousness among European Americans arose from a crucible of social movements in the late 1960s and early 1970s that included the civil rights movement, second wave feminism, environmentalism, and a shift away from mainstream religions and towards new forms of spirituality. Out of the same crucible, there came a group of new religions that revive, reclaim, and experiment with pre-Christian forms of worship, modern paganism, or neo-paganism, in which the disconnect from the past is the key feature. It is a fundamental feature that makes revival possible. Paganisms share a sense of nostalgia for an earlier time which is imagined as more spiritually whole and authentic. It should not surprise us to see the new ethnic consciousness reflected in this movement. Neopaganism can in fact be interpreted as one of a number of forms of symbolic ethnicity through which European Americans can express an ethnic affiliation. It reflects a wish to retain a sense of being ethnic without having to suffer the constraints associated with social class, discrimination, and the limitations on personal freedom imposed by traditional religious and neighborhood communities. But because they exist in a cultural climate in which primary markers of white ethnicity such as language, class, occupation, place of residence, and immigration status are attenuated, they are one step, if not several, removed from the ethnic experience. They must therefore constantly recreate a sense of authenticity and legitimacy for their members. Emergent religious movements like modern paganism can nonetheless help us understand how discourses of authenticity develop and are deployed both for good and, in some cases, for ill. There is a fine line between ethnic pride and ethnic chauvinism. While most forms of ethnic paganism offer creative settings for reimagining and performing ethnic identity, some forms veer towards ideologies that, taken to their logical extremes, are pernicious. For some pagans, this equates to genuine feelings of empathy for the oppressed, a yearning for social justice that often leads to spiritually fueled political work. But this liberal humanitarian impulse does not apply to all modern pagans. Unfortunately, the very ideas of tradition and heritage that can lead to new ways of imagining ethnicity can also be mobilized towards the goal of ethnic exclusivism and separatism.
The idea of homogeneous national whiteness is linked to a certain obsession with hygiene and cleanliness within Italy's culture of domesticity and booming consumer culture in post-war Italy. Racial identification in terms of whiteness developed at this time under the aegis and for the benefit of the political economy of Italy's modern capitalism. Italy's democratic, post-fascist, and post-colonial society was predicated on the consolidation of racial identity as uniformly and permanently white, at a moment when the colonial experience and emigration to the Americas had instead produced demographic heterogeneity. This redemptive eugenic project was mediated by, in Italy, the Americanization of daily life and the influence of American segregationist and racialist models.
On the 23rd of May 2011, President Obama addressed a crowd of tens of thousands of people at College Green, Dublin. "Hello, Dublin. Hello, Ireland. My name is Barack Obama of the Moneygall Obamas, and I've come home to find the apostrophe that we lost somewhere along the way." In these opening remarks, Obama situated himself very explicitly in relation to a narrative that in its multiple forms and manifestations is pervasive in the Irish and Irish-American imagination, the roots journey. However, Obama's journey differed from those of his presidential predecessors, John F. Kennedy and Ronald Reagan, in that Obama claims both white Irish and non-white ancestry. Several scholars have argued that claiming Irish identity in the US and or undertaking a roots journey are strongly linked with the valorization of whiteness. It must be emphasized that Obama's comments were far from a harmless rehashing of the special relationship between Ireland and the US. On the contrary, they serve to reinforce a narrative of Irish and Irish-American victimhood that has gathered momentum since the mid-1990s and was, in May, somewhat ironically authorized by America's first black president.
In examining the history of Italian-American group mobilizations and expressions of public identity in the post-war period, we see white ethnic group mobilizations and identifications building off of wartime era shifts toward cultural pluralism, not just exclusively stemming from post-civil rights shifts toward multiculturalism. In this period, they were not primarily reacting to social and political changes regarding group identity and place in the nation that were ushered in by the civil rights movement, black power mobilizations, and other minority rights organizing in the 60s. They were, in fact, helping to expand liberalism and fostering other important ideological changes that made both immigration reform and the civil rights movement itself successful in the first place. Expressions of white ethnicity found in the immigration reform movement that called for extending the promises of American liberalism to all groups did in fact do so by employing the language of white ethnic grievance during the broad civil rights era. And perhaps ironically, we see this language reappropriated by the right after the civil rights era. We have a large influx of post-war European immigrants in this period. So how do these new immigrants reinfuse ethnicity within white ethnic communities?
Next, we'll take you to a lecture on the book Celluloid Activist, The Life and Times of Vito Russo, written by Professor Michael Schiavi. Vito Russo's book, The Celluloid Closet, Homosexuality in the Movies, is universally considered a foundational work in gay and lesbian film studies. Professor Schiavi's lecture was part of the Calandra Institute's Writers Read series. On July 23rd, HBO will present Vito, a new documentary about Vito Russo's life, directed by Jeffrey Schwartz.
Vito was first and foremost an activist.
The gay people in middle America are certainly ready for it, and if the straight people aren't, then they should get to know who their neighbors are.
If you're going to talk about the gay rights movement, you're going to talk about Vito.
When I got involved in the gay movement, I was fighting for the generations that are going to come after me, so that young gay people who are 14 and 15 won't have to grow up the way we did.
These people are debating whether or not you have the right to live, and you're not part of the discussion.
He was the first person to write about how Hollywood treated homosexuals.
In the middle of the river, he went and he changed the current. You know how hard it is to do that?
It's real important that right now, whether I live or whether I die, that I fight.
He took a stand. He is our gay hero.
He was born on July 11th, 1946, in East Harlem, and his parents, Angelina or Annie, and Angelo or Charles Russo, were a young Italian-American working-class couple who adored their little boy and were enormously supportive of him, but were also a little bit surprised by him in some ways. His parents bought him a projector, a 16-millimeter projector, at a very young age. I think he was like 9 or 10, yes, when he was able to start screening movies at home. And this meant the world to him because it got him away from the kind of difficulties that he was finding as a gay kid, really out of place with his environment. Now, when Vito moved to the Village, he was not political because there was very little political sense for the gay community in 1968. The Stonewall riots, which really kicked off the modern gay rights movement, happened the following year, in June of 69. On June 28, 1969, the police were staging what was a very common raid on the Stonewall Bar, which is still in Sheridan Square. The gay bars at the time were all mafia-owned. They were constantly raided by the bar, by the police. The police would go in, they would drag people out, they would put their names in the papers the next day, they would have an arrest record. It was a mess. And a lot of people lost their jobs, and many of them committed suicide as a result of this. Come Stonewall in June of 69, finally the people who were being persecuted like this were just sick and tired of it. And for the first time they fought back. They started fighting and screaming and asserting their rights. And these riots went on for 4 days. Now, Vito actually was at Stonewall. He was not participating in it, but he watched it. The Stonewall Bar itself was one that he loved. It was, he called it the hottest dance bar in New York City. It was one of the few places in New York where two men could dance together without the bartenders telling them not to do it. It was a place that he felt a real connection to, and when it was under siege, he felt that he had to be there. He found himself an elm tree, he climbed up to a high branch, and he watched the action from the best seat in the area. 9 months go by, Vito has not joined the gay movement, which was really getting, it was taking off right after Stonewall, and then the Snake Pit raid happened on March 8, 1970, and this is what brought Vito into the gay movement. And early that morning, Inspector Seymour Pine, who had led the Stonewall raids the previous summer, burst into the Snake Pit, where he found almost 200 men in an area built for a crowd less than half that size. He arrested everyone at the bar and hauled them over to the 6th Precinct on Charles Street. Among those arrested, Diego Vinales had special reason to be afraid. He was living on an expired tourist visa in East Orange, New Jersey, and feared deportation. In this environment, Vinales panicked, bolted up the stairs, and tried to leap from a second-story window to an adjacent rooftop. He missed his target and plunged to street level, where 6 14-inch railing spikes gored his groin and thigh. Vito realized that if Vinales didn't have to be so scared of being deported, he wouldn't have jumped. And if he hadn't been patronizing a gay bar, he would not have been arrested, just like the crowd at the Stonewall last summer. These were not isolated injustices. Gay people were perpetual targets of the law. This event so angered Vito that it brought him into the movement, and he decided on the spot to join Gay Activists Alliance. In 1970, indeed up until 1986, it was completely legal in New York City to throw someone out of his or her apartment just because they were gay. It was perfectly legal in New York City to fire someone from a job just because they were gay. It was perfectly legal to deny someone public accommodations, like in a movie theater or in a park, simply because they were gay. And GAA was the first organization to decide to change that law by working within the system, so lobbying against city government to make changes that would make life better for gay people. Now, GAA was thus founded as an enormously political organization, and Vito loved that. Vito went on all the demonstrations, and he was screaming in the streets, and this was definitely a big part of his personality. But he also realized that not everybody was up for this. But Vito's idea was, there are hundreds of thousands of gay people who will never do this, who will never come to meetings, will never be political, never do demonstrations. So he developed these two programs, one called the Cabaret Night and one called the Film Night. The Cabaret Night was a program where he knew, he realized very quickly, that there were all these people in GAA who could sing. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could give these guys a chance to get up on stage and sing love songs without having to change pronouns? So they don't have to sing and pretend that they're singing to a woman, they can actually sing to men. Big hit. The singers loved it, the audience loved it, big hit. Bigger hit was the Film Night. Vito was, you know, this rabid film queen, new movies, had started to develop a collection of movies and decided, wouldn't it be great if we could screen movies with gay content, without gay content, any kind of movies, dramas, comedies, whatever, just to do it with a gay audience so that we can all react together. And we feel that we have a safe space to watch movies and comment and enjoy each other in a way that we wouldn't be doing in a mainstream theater. This was Vito's main contribution to GAA, and it's what eventually became the Celluloid Closet. Vito was looking at 75 years of Hollywood history when any gay character was represented, even tangentially, it was always as a joke. all gay characters from the silent movies of the 19-teens up into the 1980s were always suicides or outcasts or psychopaths or killers, cartoons, jokes, always. And Vito's idea was, if this is all we ever see of ourselves on the screen, is these horrible negative images, it's no wonder we don't feel so great about ourselves as a community. And it's also no wonder that society feels they can deny us our rights in housing and jobs and public accommodations, and they feel that they can bash us on the streets because that's what they're seeing of us. It's an ugly image, and we need to start reforming that image. So this was the beginning for Vito of the Celluloid Closet, which, as I said, started as this lecture series in 1973. He did this lecture for the rest of his life, and the lectures kind of filtered down into 1981 when The Celluloid Closet was published as a book by Harper and Row in June of 81, and it was a huge hit. I can't think of another academic book since that has had the kind of cachet that The Celluloid Closet had. It was written in great, funny, accessible language. People loved it. Academics took it seriously. Popular audiences ate it up. Vito went on, you know, autograph tours all over the country. It was a big, big hit, and he was delighted. Just as the book was published, literally the week of, is when AIDS hit. When AIDS started, this was a disease that seemed to be attacking only gay men at first. There was this enormous perception in society, in mainstream society, that these freaks, these faggots, have brought this fatal disease on us. We're going to blame them. We're targeting them. And homophobia went through the roof as a result.
AIDS is a test of who we are as a people. And when future generations ask what we did in the war, we're going to have to be able to tell them that we were out here fighting. Yeah. And I'm proud to be out here today, testifying with the people that I love, and to see the faces of these heroes who are fighting this war, and to be part of that fight. To steal a phrase from Michael Callan's song, all we have is love right now. What we don't have is time. AIDS activists are stretched to the limit of their time and their energy, putting out the fires of bigotry and hatred and misinformation, when what we need to be doing is fighting for drugs and research money to save the lives of the people we love. We need time to strategize the next year of this battle, and we need our friends to join us so that we can buy that time. And after we kick the shit out of this illness, we're all going to be alive to kick the shit out of this system so that it never happens again.
His legacy is visibility at any cost. If you are gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender, you must come out of the closet. You must let people know that you are who you are so that they know people like us. And this makes it so much harder to discriminate against us. If you are heterosexual, Vito's legacy is you must protest when you see people being treated the way you think is wrong. And Vito would have been the first to say that's not just for gay people. That's also in cases of racism. It's in cases of sexism, anti-Semitism. Vito was very committed to fairness and justice for everybody. So all these years later, what is Vito's legacy? Visibility, standing up, screaming at the top of your lungs, because as we see from his life, it worked. Thank you very much.
Well, that's it for this episode. Again, thanks for watching. For Italics, I'm Lucia Grillo. See you next month. Or as Dean Anthony Tamburi would say, arrivederci e alla prossima puntata.